Hello, I'm Gypsy Metellus, and welcome to Haitian Voices. Haitian Voices is a new monthly program introducing you to diverse voices in South Florida's Haitian American community. We'll bring you artists, writers, and entrepreneurs, as well as faith and political leaders. On today's program, we're talking about Haitian Creole, one of the two official languages of Haiti, and the only language that all Haitians have in common. Haitian Creole is considered one of the most historic achievements by the Haitian people and has known many challenges throughout its history, from the creation to its use. Joining us today to provide some insight into the history and significance of Haitian Creole language, we welcome Jerry Delince, publisher at Librairie Delince, Angie Bell, author and principal with the marketing firm Atizan International, and Fedo Boyer, manager of the translation company Creole Trans. Welcome. Thank you so much, Gypsy, for joining us.
Thank you for inviting us, Gypsy.
Jerry, why don't you begin with telling us what Haitian Creole represents to you as a Haitian American?
Well, as a Haitian American, I think Haitian Creole is the only way wherever I'm in the world, whether I'm in Europe or here in the Americas, I can actually speak with other Haitian people in my family.
Okay.
Really, at the very foundation, it is this common language that we all have in common. Right? So whether somebody really speaks Korean, let's say, and they're living in Seoul, I know I can speak with them in Creole. So that's really, on a very personal level, what it means to me.
Excellent, excellent. Yeah. So Fedo, why don't you give us a sense of how this language came about? I mean, I know that this could be a four-hour lecture, but I'm going to ask you to, I'm going to ask you to really be as concise as possible.
Well, I'm not quite a historian, but from what I've learned, the African slaves who were brought to Haiti came with some of their languages, and they were forced to work together, although they didn't speak the same language,
so they had
to come up with a way to communicate.
A
common language, and also to communicate with the French, their masters who were in the country. And so that's why the combination of some of the African dialects and a lot of the French language got into the formation of the Creole language.
Exactly. And so essentially it is a language created by enslaved Africans who were in Haiti. Mm-hmm. And so out of a number of languages that were uncommon, they created Haitian Creole, which became then their tool for communication.
Correct.
Right? So speaking of this tool for communication, to fast forward today, we know that it is a fully acknowledge, recognize, legal functioning language, right? So this means that its vocabulary, as you just said, is heavily French, right? But
correct.
it also includes other languages.
All sorts of languages. The island was colonized by the Spanish, the British, so you do find some Spanish words in Creole as well. You know, of course, some of the structural part of the language in terms of the syntax
mm-hmm.
of the language is based on a lot of the African languages that were brought there.
And so speaking of syntax, so Haitian Creole has a vocabulary, it has its syntax, it has its internal rules, and by that I mean all of the things that make all languages work, languages such as English, French, Spanish, etc., mm-hmm.
right?
Okay, so Angie, let's talk a little bit about how, you know, the use of Haitian Creole, whether in Haiti or in throughout the diaspora.
Well, the use is something that I think it's fascinating because of the amount of people that are learning Creole right now and the way we are communicating, mainly as a Haitian who is living in the U.S., a lot of the diaspora, they actually, mainly Haitians that were born here, as far as the young people, they didn't really learn Creole
because
the parents didn't teach them. So basically, they are fighting with it, and they are learning at the same time practicing mm-hmm. Their Creole. And when the Haitian diaspora go to Haiti, that's the only language they actually can communicate in. And you find that generation in Haiti who's also speaking French because mm-hmm. that's why they have to speak because of school. So the mixture of that I find very fascinating.
But I understood that today, especially since both Haitian Creole and French are two official languages of Haiti. I understood that so much was done in Creole that it was almost seamless, right? So from passage of laws to teaching to textbooks and to now, everyday common use, Fedo.
And now to the creation of the new
the Creole Academy.
Creole Academy.
Yes, that's right. That's right. So talk a little bit about the academy.
Well,
to give people a
for
sense
many
of
years. Users of Creole, writers of Creole, wanted to have a formalized way to use the language, and because of some of the systems that were created by different linguists, there were some inconsistencies into some ways that people spelled a couple of words, and so they wanted to put an end to that. So they adopted an official orthography since
1987, I
want to say? In the 80s, sometimes. So now there is an official orthography that everyone can follow. And to continue to do research into Creole, some of the linguists thought that it would be necessary to have an academy funded by the government, mm-hmm. who would be in charge of going further along with studies in Creole and studies on certain words, certain patterns, and stuff like that.
So I want to pick up on two points you just mentioned. The academy, the Creole Academy, mm-hmm. which is very similar to the French Language Academy, mm-hmm. and pretty much has the same role, if I'm not mistaken. And I want to talk about all the work it took throughout the years, all of the linguists, all of the Haitian writers, the literary, the journalists, and other intellectuals who contributed to really evolving Haitian Creole, right? Because as you say, today there's an official set of rules in terms of how you write, how many vowels there are, how many. What's the consonants there are, thank you, and et cetera.
Right,
and
right.
So there are clear rules. So those rules were created by teams of people over time.
Right.
Can you give us a sense of who and how and what?
Well, it's not, what linguists usually do is analyze the language after it's created.
Right.
So what they do is try to look for patterns into things that are said by different people, and then categorizing these patterns and producing a visual letter or a series of letters to represent the sounds that they hear, mm-hmm. or the pattern that they hear. I don't want people to be confused. There is no problem with the development of Creole, its use, or the fact that it's spoken by 10 million people, that it is a full-fledged language that has been used in Haiti for over, 100 years or so. So that's not the issue. The issue is more on an academic level. But if you ask the average person who speaks Creole, they're like, I've been speaking Creole since I was born.
And I've been saying this way
exactly.
for the longest time.
So there is no issue, absolutely no issue with the Creole user.
Mm-hmm.
It's just that, in the academic world, we have to figure some stuff out.
And this work goes on, right?
Exactly.
By the academicians. So Jerry, could you maybe establish a parallel for us, mm-hmm. between how work continues to be done on Haitian Creole as it is also done on other languages?
Oh, absolutely.
Languages,
I mean,
right?
I think, what I'm hearing thus far, and I have to concur with this, it makes a lot of sense to me, is that while you have an academic exercise, and canonizing the sort of structure and syntax and use through observation, the real beauty of the language ultimately is that you have regional colloquialisms and regional sort of sub-dialects of the language. And it really is a language for exchange. Like my family's from the South. Oftentimes I'll speak with someone like Angie, whose family's from the North, and they use certain terminology that I've never heard, or perhaps
regional differences,
right? So it's very much a living situation. I think also that when we speak about the language, a lot of times we're speaking about Haitians, 100% of Haitians speak an oral version of Creole in some form. A lot of what's happening today in work is to codify the sort of written language, right? And that further expands the reach of that language. It goes from being something that's formally oral to being formally written. Mm-hmm. And that's a really interesting development that we're observing right now in the 21st century.
Could you also give us a sense, and any of you can weigh in here, give us a sense of where else Haitian, well, where else Creole is spoken, yeah. right? Yeah. Haitian Creole is spoken by Haitians, yeah. so there are other Creoles around this world.
Absolutely. I mean, I can speak a little bit to Francophone Creoles because we sell books. This is the irony of ironies. We sell Haitian Creole books to other Francophone Creole speakers, right?
That is because?
Because I think there are some similarities, really specifically with Northern Haitian Creole. So if you go to Guadeloupe and you're from Cap-Haïtien, you'll pretty much be able, I think, have a conversation with someone there. Martinique has variations of Creole. We've encountered Creoles in the Francophone strain from clients of ours as far out west as, or out east in this case, as Île de Réunion. Mm-hmm. It's off the coast of Madagascar. So they speak a very Indian Ocean, I call it, mm-hmm. Francophone Creole.
Absolutely. Yeah. So they're those French-based Creoles, yeah. right? The Francophone Creoles. Mm-hmm. And they're also English-based Creoles,
absolutely.
Right? As you find in Jamaica and Trinidad.
Absolutely.
Et cetera. So, okay, fantastic. So now that we have a sense that Creole or Creoles exist throughout this world, and there are very specific countries that have officially establish their Creole as their language or the language of use of, you know, language of business, language of education, language of government for their populations, right? And so this has been done in Haiti as well. So let's not talk about what's going on in Haiti in terms of younger Haitians and their comfort level with Creole. Because what I notice is that Creole is spoken everywhere. It is written by almost all Haitian youth who are in school,
yes.
right? When in fact, that was not always the case, right? So talk about that, Angie.
As far as the comfort level, I think it's higher right now, like comparing to the older generation, because we did learn it in school.
So when you say
now,
older generation, could we have some parameters around what that means? Because that could mean Jerry and Fedo.
Of course.
Oh, it definitely means Jerry.
Uh-huh. As far as the group that graduated in the 2000s,
okay.
the group that graduated high school around the 2000s, they had the opportunity to learn Creole in school.
Okay.
And as of right now, I believe that they give you a chance in Haiti if you're writing, like when you get to Reto or mm-hmm. Philo, you can take your exams in Creole and French.
Okay.
So they actually do give you that option.
Okay.
And you can write your thesis, your like a lot of things like that, you can do it in Creole. And because the younger generation is mainly online, we can communicate with anybody in the world who the thing we have in common is the Creole. Mm-hmm. When you think people that are, like, we have a large amount of youth studying in Dominican Republic. We have, like, any other places, so the language that actually unifies us is the Creole.
Absolutely. Okay, so let's
ahead. Amazing. It's when I hear about the use of Creole by young people in Haiti, I guess I get goosebumps. Because I've been listening to some of the writing by some of the Haitian rappers, like B.I.C.
He's a great writer.
And some of these guys. And the language is so
rich.
Prose
is beautiful.
It's so beautiful.
Yes.
And mm-hmm. I kept thinking, you know, just recently, Bob Dylan was given the Nobel Peace Prize for literature. And I'm thinking, well, it is possible for a guy like B.I.C. to win the Nobel Peace Prize for literature and Creole, because the writing that they do is so complex and so interesting and so yeah. thoughtful that it could hold against any other type of writer,
mm-hmm.
whether in the U.S. or any other country.
I'm sorry, Fedo, I didn't mean to cut you off.
No,
so
okay.
I want us to get to the opportunities that exist today, whether in Haiti itself or in South Florida or elsewhere throughout the Haitian diaspora, that is where Haitians live throughout this world. How can we leverage Creole as the asset that it is, right? We're already seeing it, Jerry, the publications, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
So.
Well, I think I can speak from a couple of angles on this, but I think I'll select one, right? Because we're the largest consistent population of this particular derivation of Francophone Creole, it's almost as if our Creole could become the standard Creole, You know, sort of like if you're in Switzerland and you study German, let's say you're in Bern or you're in Zurich, you study High German, which is the German of the sort of, you know, former Prussian state, Germanic German. Mm-hmm. I think that Creole has that influence with rappers and with new books and with other sorts of art and our place sort of in the diasporic history of people of African descent here in the Western Hemisphere. A lot of people look to us and our development of Creole to inform sort of how they're developing their written Creole as well. I'm already seeing cross-current, you know, influences, at least between, let's say, Guadeloupe and Haiti. I see a little bit in Martinique. I think that may continue to spread. So that's a phenomenal opportunity, you know, to spread the language in a form that's really accessible to us because we are the largest user base, essentially, mm-hmm. of the language.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. Right. Angie, go ahead.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to.
No, that's fine.
And one of the reasons that happens is because the separation of Haiti with France, which occurred more than 200 years ago, allowed Haiti to really push in the development of its Creole mm-hmm. as an independent entity. So we were able to go further with less influence from the outside world, whereas countries like Martinique, for instance, is still under the tutelage of France and has, you know, a lot of contact with friends on the other hand.
So their Creole is not as developed.
Exactly. So we rely so much on our Creole. In fact, there are there's a good population of Haitians who are only Creole speakers.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So
100% Creole mm-hmm. phony.
Mm-hmm. Right? Absolutely, so, yeah. Absolutely. Angie, let's talk about what's being done with Creole in terms of artistic productions, poetry, rap, and other works of art.
A lot of things are being done because right now, as Fedo was saying, a lot of the rappers, they mostly rap in Creole. Mm-hmm. And a lot of young, I mean, let me stop.
That's okay.
That's okay, you're young.
We are young. A lot of new authors are writing in Creole, and at the same time, they're actually writing in both, where you can have both options, French and Creole. So one day, Jerry can testify, as far as new authors right now, they include the Creole and the French, because there is a big population that will not purchase the Creole books, but at the same time, they want to read it, they want to do more. So when you put both options, it balances out, and you like, it's being promoted more
with
the new authors.
So Fedo, I understood that you were offering Haitian Creole classes, right? An opportunity for both Haitian
yes.
Americans and non-Haitians?
It's amazing what's going on in the universities in the U.S. nowadays, is that there are a lot of the universities are offering, you know, Creole studies classes. At FIU, Nick Andre, out of the Latin American Caribbean Studies Department, is offering a Creole class for all kinds of students who are interested in international studies, Latin American studies, and it's not just for Haitians. There are a lot of non-Haitians taking the Creole classes there as well. I just started a course on the introduction of translation, Creole. Introduction to Creole translation at FIU, and it's going to move on to the next phase of Creole translation Creole document translation for the next semester. So if anybody out there is interested in taking the course, it will be on in January, mm-hmm. 2 days a week on Wednesdays and on Tuesdays and Thursdays, I think. I'm not sure about the time, but if you look it up online, you'll find the course out of the Latin American
Caribbean Studies Department. And I think Miami-Dade College also offers a number of translation courses, mm-hmm. Translation and interpretation, and I think they're trying to do it very professional-based, right? Mm-hmm. So language translation for medical use,
right.
Translation and banking, etc. Mm-hmm. So,
and the reason is we do need a lot of translation here in Miami, both to for a company to show that they have interest, that they respect the Haitian, they acknowledge the Haitian community by providing the Creole version of their items. As you know, I've been involved in the business. I own Creole Trends, and I've been involved in the business for many years. And we offer services to all, to a lot of nonprofit, government, educational institutions here in Miami-Dade. And also for individuals who are going to immigration, so we act as a as the bridge between not only the you know, for the link for language purposes, but mostly as a bridge to a cultural bridge for the Haitians into the American community.
Fantastic.
Or vice versa, for Americans to have access to the Haitian community.
Fantastic. So I'm going to ask each of you to respond to this question. And what is, in your perspective, the current status of Haitian Creole today?
I was having a conversation with one of my authors a few weeks ago, actually, before the book fair. And he was opining about lack of opportunity for books that are written fully in Creole. And I said, I think where we're at right now is where Chaucer was in the 15th century with regards to English. In the English court, everyone spoke French. If you were doing, you know, theological writing, it was largely in Latin. And Chaucer took a chance and wrote it in colloquial English. And obviously Canterbury Tales and his other works are foundational works for us in literature. I think that that's where
English
we are
literature.
From a literary standpoint, you know, where maybe English was in the 15th century, a colloquial language that didn't have this, I guess, veneer of hyper-respectability in writing.
Excellent. Angie, same question to you. Status. Or what's in our future?
I think our future looks bright, brighter.
Why?
Because we have people like Jerry, like Fedo, like you, like me, who are promoting Creole more. And we have the interest that is getting so high, whereas we have a lot of foreigners that are learning Creole. And we have a lot of job opportunities that are opening where it says, you must
bilingual.
Speak Creole, bilingual Creole and
English.
So basically, if people are getting paid to speak Creole now, I think it's like it's a new thing because you want to get paid to speak a language.
Fedo, could you also, before you answer the question, could you talk a little bit about the wonderful proverbs in Haitian Creole?
Oh, right? the proverbs are amazing. I don't know for sure, but I think it stems from the fact that when the slaves were in Haiti, they had to speak a certain way so that they wouldn't quite understand what they did. So it's sort of a coded language. I don't know if you can go anywhere in Haiti and not hear at least one of two proverbs. Sometimes they're hilarious. They're really funny.
But they're deep, aren't they? They're very deep.
And very deep. So they used to be used by older people who would tell you one sentence, which, look, you know, if you were to translate it, would look very, you know, very simple. But then the underlying message was the actual message that they wanted to set by.
Yeah.
But I don't want to forget your question, which was what's up for the future. Well, we started to do children's books not too long ago with a series of folk stories in Haiti about a cat and a dog who were friends, who usually start as friends in the beginning of the story and not end up as friends at the end. And then we also did an original story about a kid who thought they were going to on vacation. And then their mother knocked on the door, and his mother knocked on the door, and it was time to go to school. So we did this mostly to try to encourage more kids to read, and luckily, we're not the only one working on these kinds of things. Fekir Vilsin is also producing in Creole.
Right, Educavision,
From Educavision. Right. And there's a group in Canada that's also producing in Creole. There are groups in Haiti that are producing in Creole. We know of a school in Haiti, in Matinois, who's doing a project with kids from Boston, Massachusetts, where the kids in Boston are talking about their lives and putting them into kids' stories. And then we translate it for the kids in Matinois in Haiti, and we do the work vice versa for the kids in Matinois and for the kids in Boston. And it's an amazing project because all of their stories are turned into books with their own illustrations and beautifully produced, and then they exchange the books in the middle of the year or throughout the year.
And what's wonderful about that is that it is increasing the pool, the available pool of books for children in Haitian Creole, not only to be used locally, right, by Haitian children, Haitian American children here, but children in Haiti and children in other Creole-speaking countries, right? Creole, Francophone Creoles, right? Continue, Fedo. Yeah.
Exactly. And if you look at also the development of the use of Creole in Haiti, where at some point it was used only, you know, it wasn't used officially, but now it's all over. I can't think of any presidential candidate this year or the prior years, over the last 10 years, that have conducted a campaign uttering a word of French.
That's right. And French is hardly spoken anymore.
It's amazing. When we think 30 years ago, the government only used French in their communications. If you go to a doctor's office, people used to say, you know, you have to, when you go in there, you have to speak French. I was in Haiti for a year doing some volunteer work, and I walked in literally in hospitals, doctor's offices, and almost every time, everyone was speaking in Creole. The business community, which used to be considered the French, the user of French in Haiti, you go to the major marketplaces, Quabosal, the city center, where the customs agencies, all of these big businesses are conducted in Creole nowadays. You don't hear a word of French uttered. So it's going to be around for a while. The rap generation is taking it to a new level. There are new poets coming up. Bonnell is coming up. Frankie Chen is still around.
Mm-hmm. That's a wonderful thing.
So it's amazing. It's really exciting. And when you hear them say the poems and read their stories, you could feel that if you're in that crowd, you can feel that there's more of an electricity in the crowd as opposed to the French reader who comes and reads some of their stories.
So Creole has liberated Haitian people, liberated us in every aspect of life.
Exactly.
Right?
And you know, you're a former educator yourself, and in our business of education, it's going to go even further.
Unfortunately, we were out of time. Ooh. So we're out of time already. So I thank you for being here today. I'm Gypsy Metellus, and thank you so much for watching.